Thanks for returning for part two of the cover. We'll get started right away placing some dimensions on our sketches from the previous video. Let's put a dimension on this circle. There is no explicit dimension tool. Simply selecting a sketch element will cause a dimension to be displayed. I'm going to use 4 inches. I'll just select on the dimension box and type in the number 4. On this second circle, I'll do the same thing. Click here and use 8 inches. Next, I want to get these circles aligned to one another. So I'm going to sketch another line, and I'm going to start this line at the center of one circle. So I'll click and click. To stop sketching the line, I'll hit the right mouse button or escape. Now select the line. And we want to convert it to a construction line, so we'll click on this button. And next, we also want to make it a horizontal line. But you can see that it's slightly more vertical than horizontal. So if I click on this, it's going to snap to the vertical. To help myself out here, I'll click the center of the circle and drag it up slightly, reselect the line, and click on the horizontal vertical button to snap that into place. Now I can drag the circle as long as it's on a line that's horizontal from the origin. Next, I need to connect the circles with a couple of lines. Click on the line tool again, draw a line, click, click, right click or escape to get rid of that line and start another line down here. Click, click, and right click. Now you notice that these lines are not tangent at the ends, but they do have this symbol, which if I click on this down at the bottom, it says that's a coincident constraint. So the end of the line touches the circle. If I move the line, you can see it doesn't move the way I want it to move. I want this to be tangent on both ends. So to make it tangent, you can click the circle or the line and then shift click the other element. And now what's available to us is tangent. You'll need to do this 4 times. Click, shift click, tangent. Click, shift click, tangent. Click, shift click, tangent. To get the correct distance between the two, I'll just click on the construction line and then click on the dimension. And this is 9 inches. All that's left for us to do now is to trim out the sections of the circle that we don't need. So on the left-hand side, we'll grab the trim tool. And we'll have to do this 4 times. Click, 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 click. Notice that the tooltip that comes up says that the trim can also be accessed by using the T hotkey. Many of the tools available in Shapr have hotkeys, and you can see those when you get the tooltips. The hotkeys are shown right here as part of the tip. Now, if we drag any part of our sketch and try to move it, Shapr 3D is going to tell us that locked or constrained sketch parts can't be moved. And that's a good thing because we've got everything locked down with dimensions and sketch relation. Notice that the diameter dimensions that we originally put in have been converted to radius because arcs always get a radial value and complete circles always get a diameter value. To make this into a 3D feature, let's exit the sketch and then press Ctrl+1 on the keyboard, which is a shortcut for the isometric view. Now we can click inside the shape that we've just created, and these arrows are the interface for creating an extrude feature. There's 2 ways to do this. If you click on the arrow, you can now key in a number. And that's the distance of the extrude. Now I'll hit Ctrl+Z here to get back where I was and select inside again. And now if I click, hold, and drag this, that allows me to get a dynamic visualization of the extrude, and I can drop it anywhere I want. and then key in a value from there. I want to call your attention to the right-hand side of the screen where our history is showing us a list of the things that we have created. This will become more important the more complex your part gets, and we will visit this in the next video. Thanks for watching.